Blackstone Audio presents Mort, a novel by Robert Repino, read by Bronson Pinchot. For my family and my families. Then the Lord opened the mouth of the donkey, and it said to Balaam, "What have I done to you that you have struck me these three times?" Balaam said to the donkey, "Because you have made a fool of me. I wish I had a sword in my hand, I would kill you right now." But the donkey said to Balaam, "Am I not your donkey, which you have ridden all your life to this day? Have I been in the habit of treating you this way?" And he said, "No." Then the Lord opened the eyes of Balaam, and he saw the angel of the Lord standing in the road with his drawn sword in his hand, and he bowed down, falling on his face. Numbers, chapter 22, verses 28 through 31. "God is love," they once said, but we reversed that. Margaret Atwood, The Handmaid's Tale. Part 1. War. Chapter 1. The Story of Sebastian and Sheba. Before he took his new name, before the animals rose up and overthrew their oppressors, before there was talk of prophecies and saviors, the great warrior Mort was just a house cat known to his human masters as Sebastian. It was a time that now returned to him only in dreams and random moments of nostalgia that disappeared as quickly as they arose, all of it except for Sheba. The memory of her was always digging at him like a splinter under a nail. Sebastian's mother, a nameless stray, gave birth to her litter in the cargo bed of a pickup truck. If he tried hard enough, Mort could see brief flashes of those days spent suckling with his brother and sister. He could recall the warmth of his mother's fur, the rough surface of her tongue, the sound of her cooing, the smell of his siblings as they climbed over him, the wetness of their breath. He could not, however, remember the circumstances that separated him from his family. There were no records for him to consult once he became sentient. All he could do was imagine the truck driver, most likely a friend of the Martinis, his eventual owners, discovering the destitute brood while loading the vehicle one morning. Sebastian's mother probably hissed and scratched when the humans removed her kittens, but in the end, she was most likely grateful to be relieved of them. Instinct told her that she had fulfilled her evolutionary role and was still young enough to have more kittens. From that morning on, the days dissolved into one another for little Sebastian. Janet and Daniel Martini were a young couple then. The newlyweds spent their first year together renovating their house for the children they planned to have. Left to himself, Sebastian believed that he owned the place. He crept into the rafters and slunk through the newly constructed ceilings and walls. The workmen covered up the wooden beams, shooing Sebastian away from his favorite hiding spots. Once the living room was complete, Sebastian would recline in the square of sunlight on the carpet, drifting in and out of sleep, watching the dust motes floating around him. During the day, while the Martinis worked, the house was quiet. At night, Sebastian would visit his masters at the dinner table, sometimes reaching his paws up to Daniel's lap. The man wore jeans that carried the scents of his print shop, chemical cleaners and metal and ink. The manufactured odors would sting Sebastian's nostrils if he inhaled too deeply. Daniel would then lead the cat to the basement stairs, where he kept the water and food along with the litter box. Sebastian rarely thought of his siblings or his mother, until one morning when a family of strays marched in single file across the front lawn. The mother led two kittens who obediently hopped behind her. Sensing they were being watched, the mother stopped and pointed her tail in the air. She eyed Sebastian, who stared at her in return, his paws propping him up on the windowsill. She hissed. Sebastian hissed back, mimicking her. Then she extended her paw, and three sharp claws merged from the tips. Sebastian flinched. Satisfied, the mother cat kept walking. Her young ones gave Sebastian a final once-over before following. A dog's bark got them sent scurrying out of sight. The dog was Hank, a brown mutt who lived across the street. Hank seemed to have no purpose in life other than barking until he was hoarse, while his red nylon leash strained to keep him at bay. He often focused his anger on Sebastian, who slept on the windowsill when he wanted to feel the cool glass on his side. On this day, Sebastian let Hank holler for a little while before stepping away from the window. It was an act of mercy. Sebastian gazed at his own paws and noticed for the first time that the toes were not as long as those of the other cats. The digits had been sheared off. That seemed impossible, for he should have remembered such an incident. Regardless, this observation produced a moment of clarity for him. There were probably many things he did not remember about his past, living by himself in this house, sleeping away the time. Moreover, there were cats.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.